is there in the newborn cry, there in the light of every sunrise, there in the shadows of this life, your great grace. It's there on the mountain top, there in the everyday and the mundane, there in the sorrow and the dancing, your great grace, oh such grace. From the creation to the cross, cross into eternity, your grace finds me. Yes, your grace finds me. It's there on the wedding day, there on the weeping by the graveside, and for the sinner, enough for this whole wide world, your great grace.
Good morning. We want to wish everybody a good morning, a good Sunday morning, and we trust that you've had a good short work weekend with the great rains that we have and the beautiful sunny weather we've got coming. We just pray that this week has been great for you. We're going to open up our worship service this morning with just worship through music.
Precious in the honey sweet, so you love this city and you love these streets. Every child out playing on their own front door, every baby lying on the bedroom floor, every dreamer dreaming in their dead end job, every driver driving through the rush hour bar. I feel it in my spirit, feel it in my bones.
Dear loving God, we thank you so much for, like we said, a great morning that we have the privilege to gather together wherever that may be. We pray that you would, again, revive in us just the call to us that we want to be part of our communities through struggles, through whatever the case may be, uncertainties or just different decisions that are being made that we navigate. We just pray that as we're dealing with potentially loss or some form of hurts, we just pray that you would touch us, be able to reach out to those people that are mourning or ill. We just pray that you would be part of that situation, part of us in our communities. We thank you so much for, again, the freedoms that we have to do this. We don't want to take that for granted. And as we push towards getting together again, we just look so forward to that as we get together just corporately to worship and to be part of that community, part of that support group that pushes us on, that keeps us going. We pray for those who are in much more difficult situations this morning than we're facing, prosecution or whatever that might be in their countries. We just pray that you would be them with them. They deal with this on a regular basis, much, much further than what we're dealing with. And we just pray that you would give them sustainability, perseverance, and just your power to carry on. And also just to know that there's a support group around them just praying that that we would all be in that together. We commit the morning and all the aspects of this service. We pray for those who are out there that might be doing rest and relaxation, or the leaders that are still carrying forward with certain things. We just pray that you would be with them and with us into your service that way. And we pray for Pastor Kevin as he brings the word this morning. You would give him clarity, give him strength, and give him what we need to hear from you as we continue to worship through all these forms this morning. We pray this in your precious name. Amen. I'm going to get you to do as we always do. Going to get you to encourage one another, whether that's through texting or if you've chosen to get together in a very small group this morning. We're going to invite you to do that. Just take the time to just get together, encourage one another, and greet one another. We'll give you a second to do that.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, sent him to die to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
I'm going to read Psalm 80, verses 7 to 19. Restore us, God Almighty. Make your face shine on us, that we may be saved. You transplanted a vine from Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it, and it took root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. Its branches reached out as far as the sea, its shoots as far as the river. Why have you broken down its walls so that all who pass by pick its grapes? Boars from the forest ravage it, and insects from the fields feed on it. Return to us, God Almighty. Look down from the heaven and see. Watch over this vine. The root your right hand has planted, the sun you have raised up for yourself. Your vine is cut down. It is burned with fire as your rebuke, your people perish. Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the son of man you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us, and we will call on your name. Restore us, Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine on us, that we may be saved.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. Us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Oh, your grace is enough. Justice, God of Jacob, you lead the weak to make the strong. You lead us in the sing of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So remember your people. Your grace is enough.
Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and
Well, I have a pastoral.
Not supposed to do that. I have a pastoral colleague, a former pastoral colleague when I was a pastor in southern
Saskatchewan, who put something on his Facebook page this morning that caused me to smile. It's under the topic of Amazing Grace. And he wrote this: when God put a calling on your life, he already factored in your stupidity. Most comforting thing I've ever heard. I don't know whether that just hit me the right way this morning, perhaps as we begin to look at the life of Abraham later on this morning, or perhaps sometimes when we take a look in the mirror, we look at it and go, God, how could you use us? And yet God already knows. God already knows our strengths. He knows our weaknesses. He knows what we bring to the table. He knows what we don't bring to the table. And his amazing grace works in our lives and through our lives to continue to tell his story and bring the glory of God on earth. That is something that to me is an encouraging thought today. God, who knows us, God walks with us through our stories to tell his story for the glory of God. I want to welcome you this morning to our worship service. Wherever you might gather today, whichever groups you might be a part of, we are glad that you can join with us as we continue to worship together as the people of God. A few announcements, just a part of our church life is different things are taking place. Our Zoom Bible study this week will be Wednesday night at 7:30. You'll get the links that are sent out to you. If you have never been part of that and you're wanting to, you need to contact me, because the invitation links go out to only those who have responded to me already and wanted to be on that list. So it doesn't go out to everybody, just to those that are part of that group. But we are more than open to adding more people to that group, so you just have to send me an email with that request. Other groups, I believe BLAST is still meeting at this point, but check with your leaders on that, and we leave it up to the leaders to continue to communicate what is going on within our church body as well. For those of you who worship through giving, our online giving, you'll see the one of the comment notes on the Facebook page there for our live feed. We have e-transfers and direct deposits. Some people are dropping off at the church. We want to thank you for your support of our church body that way. And we just pray that we would continue as a church family, have wisdom to how God wants us to use what he entrusts into our ministry. Because it's all about him. It's his, it's for him, and we seek his wisdom for what he wants us to do. Big thank you for those who continue to donate to the local food bank here, Salvation Army. We still have our drop-off bins here. Encourage you to remember that as well. And yeah, those, I think those are just about it for as far as the announcements on things going on in the life of our church body. We read in the Old Testament, "Remember my affliction and my wanderings, the wormwood and the gall. My soul continually remembers it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Let's pray. Lord God, as we gather before you this morning, we come before you with hearts that desire to worship. Lord, we may come before you with hearts already full of worship, or we may come before you with hearts full of so many other things. But our desire, Lord, I trust, is that we can lay those things aside and come before your presence and honor and worship you as our God and King. Lord, I pray that as we are together through this online and through in person, I pray, Lord, that as we are together in your presence, that you might allow us to see something of you. That, Lord, you would restore our souls, that you would restore our hearts, we would restore our hope through the steadfast love of the Lord. Fill us with your Spirit that we might enjoy your presence and go forth empowered by you as a people of God. Lord, I pray for those in our church family. Some are going through some deep waters right now, and we do pray. We come together. Your word says when one rejoices, all rejoice. When one suffers, all suffer together. And so, Lord, we pray together for those within our body that are struggling with illness, that are struggling with fears or insecurities. And we just pray, Lord, give us eyes to see how we can be your hands and feet in practical ministry in the lives of those around us. And Lord, bring to mind people throughout our week that we would pray for, believing that when we pray, you intervene, that you come near, make your presence known, and that makes all the difference. Lord, I pray for your people this morning. May your Spirit rest upon us for the glory of God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, it's all God's children singing glory, glory. Caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals, the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, it's all God's children singing glory, glory. Tremble at what they've just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns.
Genesis 11, verses 1 to 9. Now the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, "If as one people speaking the same language they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so that they will not understand each other." So the Lord scattered them from there over all the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth.
It's there in the newborn's cry. It's there in the light of every sunrise. There in the shadow of this life, your great grace. It's there on the mountain top. There in the everyday and the mundane. There in the sorrow and the dancing, your great grace. Oh, such grace. From the creation to the cross, from the cross into eternity, your grace finds me. Yes, your grace finds me. It's there on the wedding day. It's there in the weeping by the graveside. There in every breath I breathe, your great grace. There for the rich and poor. There for the saint and for the sinner. Enough for the whole wide world, your great grace. Oh, such grace. From the creation to the cross, and from the cross into eternity, your grace finds me. Yes, your grace finds me. There in the darkest night of the soul, sweetest songs of victory, your grace finds me. Yes, your grace finds me. Oh, such grace, your great grace. Oh, such grace. Ooh. Ooh. So I'm breathing in your grace, breathing out your praise, breathing in your grace. Forever I'll be breathing in your grace, breathing out your praise, breathing in your grace. Forever I'll be breathing in your grace, breathing out your praise, breathing in your grace. Forever I'll be. Yes, your grace finds me. Yes, your grace finds me. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. My daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you.
Well, I want you to join me for a few moments of imagination. I want you to envision this morning that you are around a campfire. No social distancing required. Maybe you're chewing on the last of the manna before the day is coming to an end. It's been a time like no other. And to use an overused phrase of our time, it's been an unprecedented time. There were plagues. There was a pursuit by an army. There was this guy named Moses, and he was saying, "Let my people go," to the most powerful man in the known world. You'd been part of a group. You'd marched with maybe 2 million people as you left Egypt. You were the descendants of Abraham, the future nation of Israel. You've been on this journey. Recently, you'd left Sinai, Numbers chapter 10. You'd left Sinai and you were on your way to what was the promised land. Moses had been on the mountain. He'd been receiving the word of God, the Ten Commandments. The first five books of the Old Testament are sometimes called the Pentateuch or the books of Moses. And God gave them to us through Moses, and some of them weren't even finished by this point. You were actually living sacred history even as the Spirit of God was writing it through Moses. You're around the campfire, and you're hearing stories that you had grown up with. Now they've been codified into what is the Word of God. Stories you've grown up with, Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, Noah, Abraham, Joseph. What, Joseph, his bones are with us somewhere as we brought his bones with us out of Egypt on our way to the promised land. These stories had been passed down through oral history. But only now with Moses, through the Spirit of God, did they become codified as sacred scripture. See, when reading Genesis, when writing Genesis through the Spirit of God, Moses is recording events that he never actually lived through personally. Now again, you're around that campfire in the wilderness. You're traveling to this unknown land. Everything about your life has changed. 400 years your people had been in Egypt. Now you're traveling towards an unknown land of promise with all the concerns and worries that you have. I wonder how you relate to hearing the story of Abraham once again. This middle-aged man, an older man, called to leave his family behind, called to leave what was familiar behind in order to travel to the land of promise to be given by God himself. It's interesting for me to kind of imagine myself in certain scenes in Scripture. That's really one of the interesting aspects of Scripture. There are three audiences to Scripture. There are those who experienced God's words and activity firsthand. There are those like Noah who built the ark, experienced the word of God, experienced the activities of God firsthand. Then there are those who heard it when it was first codified into Scripture by the Spirit of God. As these Israelites were traveling through the wilderness, hearing these stories now as the word of God. And then the third audience of Scripture is us, as we continue to experience God's word today. You've heard me say before, God speaks what God has spoken. And before we can determine what a text means to us, we need to understand what it meant. This is what we want to begin to do. We want to begin today looking at a biblical biography, at sacred history, I want to give some context and some understanding of the book of Genesis this morning, through which the story of Abraham comes to us through. For myself, a summer tradition is to look at biblical biographies, to take a look at people who lived life before God and how God met with them in the midst of it. It's sacred history. And this summer, I want us to journey together, at least for the next while, through the life of Abraham. Abraham is claimed to be the father of faith by three world religions. And he holds a central position in world history and what God continues to do in the world today. He's actually referred to in the Bible. Abraham is described as a friend of God. In James chapter 2, verse 23, we read this: Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. And he was called a friend of God. It's an interesting title for someone to be called. Abraham would be called out of a pagan culture, and he would be called on a journey of faith, surrounded by many obstacles, struggled with doubts and fears. He's called to make sacrifices. He experienced griefs and losses that are common to all people. But he believed in a promise. This story begins. Genesis chapter 12. Now the Lord said to Abram, and his name isn't Abraham yet. God will change that in a story yet to come. But the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abraham went as the Lord had told him. This is the introduction to Abraham. But before we get too deeply into the life of Abraham or the life of Abram, I want us to understand the context through which his story is lived out. And so by way of that this morning is an introduction to the life of Abraham, really by understanding something of Genesis. So it might be some scattered thoughts here and there, but trustfully they come together. See, before we zoom in on our Google Maps to the very specific life of Moses, I want us to zoom out and get a larger picture of the field in which he lives, to see what God is doing with Abraham's life and the larger story that Abraham is a part of. And as we see some of that larger story that Abraham is a part of, we in turn see some of the larger story that we continue to be a part of today. So Abraham's story is found in the book of Genesis. Genesis is the easiest book to find in your Bible. It's the very first one. Genesis is the book of beginnings. Genesis was a book that was compiled and written by Moses through the Spirit of God. We understand, the Bible tells us in 2 Peter chapter 1 that no man brought about the Scripture by their own interpretation or their own understanding. But the Spirit of God carried holy men of God and through them brought us the Scriptures. We also read in 2 Timothy that all Scripture is God-breathed. It all comes from God and is profitable. That being said, we don't read all parts of the Bible the same way. Genesis is a book of beginnings. Genesis comes from God, and every part of the Scripture is from God, but we don't read the Bible, all of its parts, the same way. Some parts of the Bible are letters. Some are commands. Some are sermons. Some are poetry or wisdom literature. Some of them is future prophecy, and some of it, like what we're entering into here, is what's called sacred history. Abraham's story is communicated through God's word in something that is sacred history. And it's important for us to understand what that is and what that's about and how to approach it. You might be asked the question, do you understand the Bible literally? Do you take the Bible to be literal? Which I would say yes, but I read the Bible literally meaning that it is accurate and true. It means what it says, but we also have to read the Bible contextually. Meaning that it the Bible is literal in that it means what it says in the way that it says it. This is important when we come to reading sacred history. Just because someone did something doesn't mean that sacred history is calling us to do the same. That reads it a little bit different than if we're reading one of the epistles of Paul, where we're given direct commands. When we read sacred history, just because somebody did something doesn't mean the scriptures are calling us to do the same. We often have to go elsewhere in the scriptures to interpret the morality or the ethics of the recorded decisions of the people involved in the story. And that's what I like about sacred history, is these parts of the Bible, they speak to what people did do, not necessarily what they should have done and how God met them in the midst of it. It's what I call truth with skin on. See, should Abraham have lied? Should he have had a child through his wife's servant? Should he have offered up Isaac as a sacrifice? Should David, when he was in a cave, have spared Saul's life when everyone around him was saying, look, here's your opportunity. Take out your enemy. Should Esther have hid her Jewish heritage and just blended in until that pivotal moment where she's called to identify herself with the people of God for the saving of many? Should Jonah have obeyed God and gone and preached in Nineveh even when he didn't feel like it? Is that being authentic? When we read sacred scripture, we're reading what people did, but the commentary on what they did often comes from somewhere else. The Bible is literal in what it records. It is true and accurate, but we approach our understanding of how God communicates through sacred history, through poetic imagery, through the sermons and through the teachings and through the laws and commands. We approach these things in somewhat different ways. And our goal when we read the Bible, when we read the scripture, is to understand what is God communicating to us. What is God communicating to us through the type of communication, the type of scripture that he chooses to speak? And when it comes to sacred history, what is written is true, it is accurate. But what we do with it might not always be completely evident within the confinements of just a single story of the text. See, if we didn't read scripture differently, then we'd be sitting back thinking that Solomon married a woman whose hair was a flock of goats. We understand that we read things differently in different parts of scripture. It's all truth. What is God trying to say? What is God trying to communicate through the various aspects of the story of Abraham's life? Genesis is a book of beginnings. Through it, we see creation. We see Adam and Eve. We see the fall. We see the flood. We see the Tower of Babel. And we see the story of Abraham and his family. And it's sacred history through which God reveals himself. And when we read sacred history, we understand the star of the story is God. How does God meet with people in their mixed up, goofy lives? Now, it's important to come to terms with Genesis as being sacred history. It's important to do that for a number of reasons. There's a lot of debate that comes through the book of Genesis. I've on occasion thought, and I haven't done it yet, that I'd like to do a sermon series just on Genesis 1 to 3. Genesis 1 to 3 probably touches on almost every controversial social issue of our day and is one of the most challenged aspects of the Bible. It's important to come to terms with Genesis' social history. For some people, they read parts of Genesis differently. Some read Genesis chapter 1 to 11 differently than they do chapter 12 to 50, where the story of Abraham begins. Now, some of you like to know this kind of information. Some of you, you'll maybe be a bit sleepy till I go on to the next part. But some read Genesis chapter 1 to 11 as something called a cosmological genre. And what does that mean? It means they read it as far as this communicates to us something about the origin of the universe, but they do not believe it is literal history. And that changes when you reach chapter 12, and you begin with chapter 12 being literal history as you look at the life of Abraham. The challenge with that is for those that read the Bible that way and read Genesis in that manner, and it is becoming ever so popular to do so, is it calls into question the understanding of things like the creation week, or the literal existence of Adam and Eve, or a universal flood, or so forth. Now the problem, and some of you, and sometimes you'll look in your study notes and you'll see some of this differentiation, this different teaching. The problem is, if you're going to say that Genesis 1 to 11 should be viewed differently than Genesis 12 to 50, then there needs to be some internal clues in reading the text that cause you to realize a change has taken place. One of the things I would challenge you to do is just to sit at home with your Bible, take it and read Genesis 1 to 15 in one sitting. Doesn't take that long. In my Bible, it's about 11 and a half pages. Read Genesis 1 to 15 in one sitting. What you will find is there's nothing within the text to convince you that once you reach chapter 12, the story of Abraham, you should change your understanding of the text from something symbolic to now it's literal sacred history. When you read it through that way, you won't find things in the text to say, oh, this is fables, this is meant to teach us about God and creation, but it's not literal, and now suddenly it is. There are not indications in the text that would allow you to change your understanding. Because of that, I would affirm that all of Genesis is sacred history, that it all happened, that God created the world in a literal 6 days, that Adam and Eve were real people, that the fall was a real event, that Eden was a real place, that Noah built a big boat, that there was a universal flood, that the Tower of Babel was real, and that God called Abraham out of a polytheistic pagan culture in what would one day be Babylon, with a promise and a plan that carries through the rest of Genesis as sacred history. Now, as you read through Genesis, you may struggle with some aspects of that. And by all means, we can disagree. And you can disagree with the Bible's teaching and say, Genesis 1 to 11 isn't real stuff. It's symbols. But it's tough for you to come away with that understanding. If you sit in one sitting and read through Genesis 1 to 15, you will find that it flows with the same kind of language, the same kind of understanding, and the same kind of genre of scripture, that it is all sacred history and speaking truth. This is what really happened. These were real events. So what is the book of Genesis all about? Ultimately, what Genesis is all about is it's sacred history that reveals God. Genesis is a book of beginnings, is about the revelation of God. This is an introduction to who God is, the beginnings of it all, and it starts with God as a creator. Now, there is a difference. There is a difference that takes place here between Genesis 1 to 11 and Genesis 12 to 50. Genesis 1 to 11, God talks to mankind globally. He talks to all of mankind throughout the whole earth. And then there's a switch that takes place in chapter 12 where now God is talking about one man and one family, Abraham and all that follows. What is Genesis about? Genesis is about the revelation of God. But then it's also about how that revelation becomes distorted after the fall. And then it continues on to be about God's plan to reclaim and restore the revelation of himself to a lost humanity. And this is really what Abraham's story is about.
God created, God revealed himself. Sin entered the world. Our independence from God began to distort the image of who God is. There is a lost revelation of God. And then God set about his plan to restore and reclaim the revelation of himself to a lost humanity. This is what Abraham's story is about. The beginning of recovering the right revelation of God. The scripture text we read this morning is really a prelude to Abraham's story. We read the story of the Tower of Babel. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they had bricks for stone, and story carries on. Say, come, let us build for ourselves a city and a tower with its top to the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, behold, they are one people and they have one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, its name was called Babel, or Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of the earth. Chapter 11 comes to an end. There are some genealogies that take place there, and then there is a change. God has been relating to mankind globally. But now he changes his focus in chapter 12 and narrows the focus to one family. See, what has taken place in Genesis to this point? There's been creation, then there's been the garden, then there was the fall. After that, the Bible says that mankind continued to disregard God to the point that every intention of their thought was only wicked or evil all of the time. God decided that he would bring a flood, but he would preserve man through Noah. And it began again after Noah. But that continued because the sin nature is part of mankind. Because we have this independence from God that disregards God, we go our own way. All we like sheep have gone our own way. Each one. There is this continued lost revelation of God. And it begins to go on this path again, distorting who God is, until we finally reach the culmination of that being the Tower of Babel. Continuously, the image of God becomes distorted among humanity. Now, it's interesting, the area of Babel, the area where this was built, is the same region as Ur, and that is the land that Abraham was called out of. Eventually, this area of Babel, and it's somewhere in the area of modern-day Iraq, eventually this would become Babylon. And when you read about Babylon throughout the scriptures, it seems to have this symbolic symbol significance throughout the Bible right up into the book of Revelation. Babylon represents this pagan and secular life and land, which although the people of God may from time to time find themselves living within for a season, God calls us out from Babylon to be a distinctive people of God. And God would call Abraham out of the land of Ur to send him on a journey to the land of Canaan. It's the same area that the Tower of Babel was said to have been. Now, archaeologists, I can't get that word right. You know the one I'm thinking. They have found remains in this area, about 30 of them. These towers, they're pyramid-like. They have a name. They're called ziggurats. And they're pyramid-like structures that are 60 to 200 feet tall. And these have been found in the area where the Tower of Babel is thought to have been, and in the area of where Ur would have been and Babylon. There's about 30 of them I found. It's pyramid-like, but it's different than a pyramid. There is no interior. It's solid. And it would be built to the height of 60 to 200 feet. On the outside of it would be steps. And the steps from the outside would lead up to a shrine on the top of the tower. And the shrine on the top of the tower was supposed to provide access to the gods and their movements from the heavens to the earth. And so different one of these ziggurats might be dedicated to different gods within their belief system. But they built them as a means to assist the gods and to facilitate them coming from their journeys between heavens and earth. One commentator writes that they were designed to make it convenient for the god to come down to his temple, receive worship from the people, and bless them. People during this time, they're building this tower, and God responds to it by scattering them and scattering their languages. Some ask the question, what is at issue here in the Tower of Babel? Is it merely disobedience? Well, that is part of it. Is it pride? Look at what we can do. Well, that might be part of it. But ultimately, what the story of the Tower of Babel is about is a distorted view of God. As they created this, as they built this, they were bringing about a diluted view of God that said God or gods have human needs and benefit from human help. This is what takes place to this day. We create gods. We distort gods. We dilute the image of gods. Today, we don't have idols per se that we make out of our hands. Instead, we have idols of ideas, where we create a god in our mind that is our own creation, but not the God who is. Book of Revelation is about the revelation of the God who is, and how through sin there is a distortion and a dilution of that revelation that takes place. This continues right on through into the New Testament. When we read Paul writing in the book of Romans, he says this: "For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creepy things." Paul goes on to say in Ephesians chapter 4, he talks about those without God, referring to them as Gentiles. And as he talks to those who are without God, he says that we must no longer walk as Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding and alienated from the life of God. Why? Because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. And as their hearts became callous, they've given themselves over to all kinds of life that is apart from God. What is the story of Abraham all about? Ultimately, the story of Abraham is about the recovery of the revelation of God. That is the context. God reveals himself, but who he is becomes diluted, becomes distorted, right down to the Tower of Babel. And then what happens? The story narrows. And God begins to tell the story of one man and the family that follows. The story of Abraham is really the story of recovering the revelation of God. God would call this one man to become a nation that he would relate to as the nation of Israel. That God would use his relationship with Abraham and ultimately the nation of Israel to give a picture of what a relationship with God is like. He would use that nation to prepare the world for a Savior through which all people would be blessed. He would call Abraham, and as we go from here, we're going to zoom in to the life of Abraham. We're going to see him as a normal person. A person with struggles, with insecurities, with impatience, but also a person with faith who hears God, believes God, and follows God and becomes part of a bigger story, a story about recovering the revelation of God. That is Abraham's story. But the story hasn't changed. The story hasn't changed, and we can see ourselves in the story that follows. Within all of our failings, within all of our goofiness, and within all of our moments of great faith, God continues to build a people for himself to recover the revelation of God to a lost world. This is how the story continues, and it continues to be your story. It continues to be my story. Not always what we should have done, but what we have done, and how God, with his grace, meets us within those moments. How God restores us. How God walks with us through faith struggles, through griefs and losses, through not sure what's going to happen next. How he takes us from places of comfort to places that he says, this will be a blessing, but the journey there will not be easy. God walks us through those stories, and the world around, the people around watch and say, why? Why does this person respond to God this way? God's story, he continues to tell through your life. He tells it through the people of God. He tells us through the church. The story is about recovering the revelation of God through the people of God. So Abraham went as the Lord has told him. Let me ask you this morning, how is this story continuing to be lived out in your life? Now, I haven't told you the story yet. We'll do that in the weeks that follow. But I want us to understand the context in which it is in. Genesis is about the revelation of God, losing and distorting that revelation of God, and then God's plan through Abraham and who follows to restore that revelation of God to the world. How is that story continuing to be your story? As God has called you to Christ by his grace, he calls you out of Babylon. We'll see that in what follows. But he calls us to be a distinct people of God. We've heard the words of Jesus before where he has said this: you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Just a bit before that, Jesus said this: you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its salt taste, if the salt has lost its taste, if those called to be part of the recovery of the revelation of God have lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world, a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its taste, where the world has lost its revelation of God, where who God is has been diluted and distorted, where who God is a mystery and made up to so many. You are, and together as the church, we continue to be the restoration of the revelation of God through the people of God. Dear people, this is your story. This is my story. And as we sit around the campfire in the middle of our journey, the present day third audience of the story of Abraham, what God was doing through him, will we hear afresh a journey of faith that is our journey of faith? Will we hear afresh a journey of faith that we too are called to live within? Your story, my story, the recovery of the revelation of God through the people of God. Amen.
going to close our service this morning with the same love.
You choose the humble and raise them high. You choose the weak and make them strong. You heal the brokenness inside and give us life. The same love that set the captives free. The same love that opened eyes to see is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide, the same God that was crucified is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. You take the faithless one aside and speak the words, you are mine. You call the cynic and the proud, come to me now. Set the captives free. The same love that opened eyes to see is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide, the same God that was crucified is calling us all by name. Calling us all by name. Oh, 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 oh. You're calling us to the cross. You're calling us to the cross. You're calling us to the cross. That set the captives free. The same love that opened eyes to see is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide, the same God that was crucified is calling us all by name. You are
restoring, reclaiming the revelation of God through the people of God. That is really the story that starts out here with Abraham. That continues to be our story. And as we go into our weeks, corporately as the church, and as each part of it, we continue to be part of a story of reclaiming the revelation of God through the people of God, through all of our goofiness, and through the way the grace of Jesus is poured out in reclaiming and restoring our own lives. That's a challenge with introductions, to begin with a wide view, and now we begin to zoom down into the individual details of Abraham's life. In many ways, he's like the church planter who begins to establish that which will follow. I encourage you to read his story in the coming weeks as we continue to look at different aspects. But just remember what the purpose of that story continues to be. It's the same as the purpose of the church. As we go into the world to make disciples, we go to be a light in the world, we go to shine forth. This is who our God is. And he's made himself known in the story of my life so that you can read it and perhaps invite him into the story of your life. Lord God, I pray that as we leave our places of worship this morning, that your Spirit would fill us, that you would direct us, that you would bring to mind in this coming week the question of how we are being part of restoring the revelation of God through the people of God. I pray, Father, that we wouldn't just see that as belonging to the person next to us, but we would see that within your call upon our lives. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your power. We thank you for the cross and the Lord Jesus through which we have entered into this story by faith. Lord, I pray for your people as they go out. Please walk with them and bless them and protect them in what you have for them this week. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
Of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, none were meant to persist. Of all the spells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, and all the power
of darkness tremble at what they've just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. 'Cause all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah.